Welcome to this webinar on replayer or replace. Learn about the best treatment for defective restorations. I am Jon Dahl, Managing Director at NIOM and also a professor in cardiology, dental faculty, University of Oslo. The International Dental Association expressed concern about the expenses used for failed restorations. That was in a report in the year 2000. A recent study from Norway showed that still 1/3 of the dentist working time are used to treat failed restorations. There is a concept of minimal invasive dentistry that has been taught for some years. And the reason for that is that fillings are not permanent and that the main reason for failure are secondary caries and filling fractures. That's also expressed by a famous Swedish dental surgeon, Dan Eriksson, in the year 2000. When you are going to remove a complete filling, also sound tooth substance will be removed. And this study showed that when you are removing a large filling, 3 times more sound tooth substances was removed compared to a dental amalgam. So, repair rather than replace preserves tooth substance. Is it possible to get some advice whether you should repair or replace a defect filling? The Cochrane collaboration makes survey of available literature on different aspects. And in 2014, they published a systematic review on replacement versus repair of defective restorations. And what was their conclusion? Their conclusion was that there was no published randomized control trial relevant to this question. So, what was we recommended to do? We were recommended to use our clinical experience, the individual circumstances, and the patient's preferences should decide whether we should repair or replace a restoration. This seminar is conducted to give you some information and some guidance on how to repair and when to repair or replace a failed dental restoration. The first thing you often do when you are wondering about a clinical problem is to ask a colleague. And this study among 200 dental surgeons in US and Scandinavia, including 9,500 restoration, asked that question. Composite restorations are more likely to be repaired than dental amalgam restorations. And concerning who made the initial restoration, it's more likely than that you do a repair when you have made the restoration yourself. What type of tooth is more likely to be repaired? This study showed that molars are more likely to be repaired than failed restorations in premolars. But what do they teach our students? This is a survey from 42 different dental schools showing whether they were teaching repair or replace in different clinical situations. Marginal defects, discoloration, and partial loss of restorations. Most schools were in favor of repair. For cases of secondary caries, surface wear, and bulk fractures, schools were both in favor of repair and to replace the failed restorations. And in cases of marginal ridge fractures and isthmus fractures, most schools taught the students that they should replace the filling. A familiar clinical situation is tooth fracture adjacent to a direct composite restorations. And we can see that in anterior teeth, 43% of the school thought that repair was better than replace. But concerning cusp fractures and cracked teeth, most schools taught their students that they should replace the entire restoration. This is a study comparing restorations that were replaced and restorations that were repaired, and looking into the annual failure rate. And you can see in the cases where fillings were repaired, the right side of the picture, the annual failure rate was much lower than when fillings were not repaired. So to conclude on this aspect, repair is favorable due to reduced treatment time, reduced cost to the patient, and reduced risk of harmful effects on the pulp, because you do not remove that much sound tooth substances when you are preparing a restoration. So how to do a successful repair? There are three important issues: the remaining restoration, the bonding system, and the causative factor, the reason for the failed restoration or cracked tooth. Let's start with the remaining restoration. It is advised that you use some sort of a macro mechanical retention, like a dovetail, as you can see on the figure here. This dovetail supports the joint between the old and the new filling material, and it also reduces the stress to the bonded area. In addition, it is recommended that you use a diamond burr to make this dovetail. A diamond burr improves the micromechanical retention, as you can see on the scanning electron microscopy picture on this slide. If the failed restoration is a dental amalgam, or if the repair had to be done close to a dental amalgam, it is advised that you use sandblasting using silicium dioxide. That improves the retention towards dental amalgam. You need to use a bonding system. Repairing a restoration without using a bonding system is most likely to be a failed repair. There has been a lot of literature concerning composite repair and what are the strengths that you obtain. There are mainly two different ways of testing this. It's the shear bond strength testing and the tensile strength testing. Let's look into the methods of the shear bond strength testing first. You start with the old restoration, and in the laboratory we call it the test substrate. Then you do a surface treatment. You add the bonding agent and the repair material. This picture shows how the test specimen look like before we start the testing. Usually we age the test specimens for some days or months before we start the testing. And when testing, we apply a force 90 degrees on the bonded surface. So what results do we obtain? This is a study recently done at NIOM. And we can show that if you use a bonding system without silane, you get a lower bond strength compared to a situation where you use a silane on the surface first, or as for the Scotch Bond Universal, a product that contains silane. In this study, the old restoration or the old substrate was 6 years which is comparable to restorations in a patient mouth that fails for some reason. Sometimes a newer restoration also fails. And in these cases, when we repair them, we can see that the bond strength between the old and the new composite is higher. And also in these cases, the use of silane improves the bond strength. But what does actually these numbers tell you between 5 and 25 megapascal? If you do a bond study between composite, bonding system, and dentin, you get numbers between 25 and 5 megapascal. So you can see when you're repairing a restoration, you get also bonding strength that is comparable to the bond strength between a composite and the dentin. This is a schematic presentation of how a tensile strength test is done. Again, we start with the aged substrate, then we do some surface treatment, we add the new composite. Again, the test specimens are aged. They are cut in smaller pieces like matches, mounted in a special test machine, and then it's pulled from each other. What are the results in these cases? Here we have three different bonding systems, and we can see the green bar, which is the control material, which is the composite itself. And the bonding shows that the repair strength is half to two-thirds of the bond strength of the composite itself. But also in these cases, we added some silane to the surface of the old composite, and we found that the bond strength increased, and for one of the products, it was nearly the same as the control material, the composite itself. When you are gluing two pieces together, you try to get as thin as possible gluing zone. And this was also the thoughts of this study. If you leave the bond system uncured and squeeze the new repair composite into the bond system or into the bond agent, you will get a very thin bonding zone. And we did so in these experiments. And they showed that the bond strength increased in the cases where we left the bonding system uncured. In many cases, you also had to bind the repair material to the sound dentin or enamel. And this figure shows the different types of dental adhesives, the edge and rinse system, and the self-etch systems. The multi-bottle and acid etch system in the upper left part of the figure is the initial type of dentin bonding. And then you have the acid etch and one bottle with a primer and the adhesive. And on the other side, you have the self-etch system with an acidic primer and the adhesive in two different steps, or the all-in-one or one-step systems where the acidic primer and the adhesive is mixed into one bottle. The recommendation given to the students at the dental faculty is the so-called selective etch. So you start by etching the enamel with phosphoric acid, and then you use a two-step self-etch on dentin and enamel. And it is recommended that you use a mild type of the two-step self-etch with a pH of about 2. The last part that is of importance is the reason for the failure. This figure shows the fate of repaired restorations caused by fracture or caries. When the initial cause for the failed restoration is fracture, the repaired restoration has a lower survival time than fillings that are repaired due to caries. And why is it so? Let's look into this study in more detail. Approximately 90 restoration was due to tooth, or 90 restorations were repaired due to tooth fracture. Half of these repair was rated as unsuccessful. 100 teeth was repaired due to caries, and 1/4 of these restorations were repaired and were unsuccessfully repaired. And why was this restorations unsuccessful? If we can see on the tooth fracture group, 53 or half of the unsuccessful repair was due to a new fracture. And for in the caries group, half of the unsuccessful repair was due to caries. This shows that the initial cause of failed restoration appears again. So we have to do something about that. The reason for the initial failure must be taken care of. So you have to remove excess occlusal loading in the cases of fracture, and you have to do some caries prevention in the case of caries. So to finalize, I will give you some guidance on to repair or to replace. It's easy to say that you should use your clinical experience. And by that, I mean that you shall keep the minimal invasive dentistry in your mind. You can repair when there is a good quality of the remaining restoration and when the remaining restoration is larger than the repair. If this is not the case, then you have to replace the restoration. If you go for repair, a successful repair requires macromechanical retention, micromechanical retention, the use of dental adhesives and silane, and not to forget, you have to reduce the risk for a new failure. Thank you for listening.